Welcome to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial. This morning during the program, your host, Marc Freedman, may discuss specific financial planning and investment ideas. These discussions are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations. Financial planning and investment advice is offered through Freedman Financial, an SEC-registered investment advisor located in Peabody, Massachusetts. Securities are offered through LPL Financial, a member of FINRA and SIPC. Freedman Financial is a separate entity from LPL Financial. Investing involves risk, including loss of principal. Always consult a certified financial planner professional, qualified attorney, or tax advisor prior to investing to determine what is appropriate for you. Listeners to this radio show should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the investment company carefully before investing. The prospectus contains this and other information about the mutual fund, variable annuity, and variable annuity subaccounts. To obtain a prospectus, you may contact Freedman Financial or your financial advisor. Prospectuses should be read carefully before making a potential investment. And now, here's the host of Dollars and Cents, Marc Freedman of Freedman Financial.
Good morning and welcome to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. My name is Marc Freedman. I'm president and CEO of Freedman Financial, located in Peabody, Massachusetts, right across the street from the North Shore Mall and just above Daniela's Ristorante at 41 Cross Street in Peabody. Hope you're doing well this morning. We've had a nice weekend, great weather outside. It was in the 70s, so I've kind of enjoyed spending some time outside. Even last night, got a little windy, but still a nice night to hang outside. No mosquitoes around, no bugs around, just kind of hanging out and enjoying it. And, of course, we watched the Red Sox win. Yeah, tied it up with the Houston Astros yesterday. It was a long game, though, huh? I mean, second inning, we were about an hour and a half in. It's because, I mean, what is that 41-minute wait for a new pitcher to come in for the Astros?
Just by the second, by the time the second inning was over, it's like, okay, game should be over by now.
That's right. And you thought, you wondered whether Nate Eovaldi would be able to continue to pitch the way he pitched in the first inning. And but he held on. He did his five innings or so. I mean, he got a little shaky there, gave up a couple runs, but. Two grand slam home runs by the Red Sox. First in the first, another one in the second. You felt pretty good, but then around, I'm watching the game, ninth inning comes around, and all of a sudden they start hitting home runs off the reliever, and I'm like, they're not going to come back, are they? Yeah. Now, it was too much of a buffer, but I'm very happy that the Red Sox split in down in Houston, and they're back here on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
They're in good shape.
I think their pitching lineup's in pretty good shape. I think the Astros might have a bit of a problem with starting pitching right now.
That's their Achilles heel. I mean, I guess their ace is out.
Their ace is out, yeah. And this guy, I forget what his last name was, who started yesterday, but I guess he's got a knee injury or something. He had to be pulled out.
Yeah, you probably don't want to start him again.
Well, I don't know. I mean, we'll see if he's coming back. And I mean, look, if the Red Sox bats can continue, that'll be great. I mean, yes. Kiki Hernandez is having a great run, but I mean, look, I mean, he's got to cool off too. But Schwarber, whatever his name, what's his first name? Kyle Schwarber. Yep. I mean, he's having a miserable game so far. He just can't get the bat on the ball, and hopefully he'll come around a bit. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's all picking up. Everyone's playing their role. It's all good.
Now JD is. I mean, when he came up, I said, this kid's going to give up a grand slam. I know he is.
Well, you know,
I said he's going to. Because he won't walk him, so he'll give up a grand slam. Yeah,
but when JD hit that ball, I thought that was just going to be a line drive.
Me too.
There was no way that thing was going out.
A line drive to the right fielder.
Right fielder. I had no idea there was that much power behind it.
And 2 seconds later, it was out.
It was gone. So I don't know. It's nice, and we got the Patriots today at 4:25 right here in North Shore 104.9. Pre-game starts at
1:30
here. So lots to talk about
against
there.
Dallas. That's going to be a good game.
Yeah. What's your prediction there?
Well, I mean, I think it would be very difficult for the Patriots to beat them, but I mean, it's possible. They're playing at home. I mean, Dallas has a good team. What I'm worried about is Dallas likes to run up the middle, and they're good at it. And we're not good at stopping that.
Yeah, the Patriots have a lot of holes right now.
They do.
Certainly in their offensive line, they've got some holes.
So, I mean, we'll see. I mean, you know, you got the young quarterback. You know, I mean, Dallas is a real team. I mean, it's a good litmus.
Finally.
It's a good litmus test for sure.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if they lose, I wouldn't be shocked. But if they won, I wouldn't be shocked either.
Hey, but remember, a couple weeks ago, when you asked me what my prediction for the Patriots game against Tampa was.
Mm-hmm.
Now, granted, I said it was going to be 40-6, and it was going to be Mac Jones's breakout game. Now, of course, that wasn't the score. But the Patriots played pretty well against Tampa Bay. They did. So we'll see.
You know, it seems like they play to the competition. Like, you know, they played Houston, and Houston's not a good team, and they played horribly.
Yeah.
They played Tampa, and Tampa's a good team, and they played pretty well. So I'm thinking they should play pretty well against Dallas. So.
Yeah. What I think is kind of interesting, watching the Red Sox, watching the Patriots, Bruins, I think, opened last night.
They did.
Did they win last night?
They won 3-1.
All right. And Celtics open, I think, next week sometime.
I believe next week, yeah.
And I find it interesting when watching some of these sporting games now, they're now putting betting lines out. Because there's all sorts of, you know, if you bet $100, you could win $400. If so-and-so hit, you know, a home run during this inning or whatever. I mean,
what were they talking about during the game, early in the game? What's the over-under on...
run scored? Or
Evaldi, seven strikeouts or more.
That's right, it was seven strikeouts or more. It was like... Yeah, it was 400-1.
He had none. Yeah. I think he ended up with one.
Yeah, one or two. That was all it was.
Well, when you get an 8-run lead, you tend to throw, you just let him hit the ball.
Right. Just trusting your defense, I guess.
Right.
So it's been interesting. I mean, the world has changed. When we remember, before we couldn't even talk about betting in sporting events.
Pete Rose. It was illegal.
It was illegal, right? And now
it was illegal.
Right. Now, so Pete Rose is now out of the Hall of, not allowed to be in the Hall of Fame, and some people are going, who the heck's Pete Rose? But
you know that lottery thing that you know that you see at the convenience store? That was illegal. Right. People went to jail for that.
So things have changed. Then again, you know, buying drugs at your local dispensary was illegal too.
That used to be illegal. So there's a theme here, Mark.
Yeah, I know. things that are illegal will soon be legal. I don't know. Well, certainly when it comes to investing, there are certain things that are very illegal. And things that I would not recommend, and you've got to be very careful about some of the stuff you've gotten into. Someone was actually talking to me yesterday about Bernie Madoff and how they ran into somebody that they knew who had invested with Bernie Madoff and how this family lost all of their money. And then there was also the clawback that was reached out to them because they started getting income from their Bernie Madoff investment, and they were being asked to give it back. Because it wasn't really their earnings, but they didn't know that. But so one of the pieces of advice that I give to people when it comes to investing, and everybody seems to want to invest these days because the market has been doing so well over the year. Yes, the past 3 months have been about flat, not necessarily bad, it's been flat. But, you know, the interest in investing these days, whether it's in these crazy cryptocurrencies, in hard assets and what are called alternative assets, whether it's real estate, whether it's art, whether it's collectibles, whether it's regular ordinary securities like stocks or bonds or mutual funds or index funds, everybody seems to have an interest in something. I want you to be careful. When someone invites you to be a participant in an investment, certainly an investment that might be securities related, you want to be sure that you're writing your check to a well-established custodian. That could be writing a check to Fidelity or Charles Schwab or Merrill Lynch or LPL Financial or I don't know, there's so many of them, whether it's Vanguard or whomever. But don't write it to the Marc Freedman Financial Institution Company. Don't write your check even to Freedman Financial, my company. That's inappropriate if you're using it for investments. You write your check to the institution, whether it's American Funds or Putnam Funds or Schwab or Fidelity. Remember, there was a company that Bernie Madoff called, I think it was Bernie Madoff Investment Strategies or something like that, Bernie Madoff Investments. You write a check for that. You're now giving Bernie Madoff the opportunity to take your check and then invest it wherever he wants to. Even though he might say he was going to do it one way or another, he gets to make that call of where they want to invest the money. Don't do it. And I don't care how good it sounds. Remember, I think it was Curt Schilling at one point. Remember, Curt Schilling was pitching for the Red Sox, and then after he got out of the Red Sox, he started his investment company and all this video game stuff. And he said, well, you know, you want to invest in Curt Schilling's company, or maybe David Ortiz starts up an investment company. You want to invest in David Ortiz's investment company? Look how much money these guys make. They've got to do really well. Well, there is huge risk attached to that. There is no guarantee that they are going to invest your money the way that you anticipated. When you go with a securities company, when you go with a custodian, someone who is registered, someone who carries what's called SIPC, Securities Investor Protection Corporation Insurance, you can feel far more comfortable. In fact, just this past week, I met with a child of, well, he's an adult child now. He's like 28 years old, of a client of mine. He's got a job out in California. You know, he's doing very well. He is a little confused about what he should be doing with his money. And so the parent said, hey, why don't you just reach out to Mark and he'll hold a call with you. And sure enough, I did. We did it on Friday. We had a Zoom call. And so he was out in California. I was there and he wanted to just get some advice. He's 28 years old. All of a sudden, he's making more money than he ever imagined. And it was interesting having a conversation with him. He's working for one of these big tech companies. And I started asking him about his financial situation. First, he told me how much he was making. And so he gets a salary. He also gets some stock units, all that stuff. But at 28 years old, he was making close to $200,000 a year. Not bad. But in addition to that, he's been working really hard about saving his money. But what he does is he continues to take the advice of people that he talks to on different types of investments, or different types of investment accounts, I should say. And what I realized was that he has a total of $80,000 saved. Not bad for a 28-year-old. $80,000 saved. And they're in seven different, not investments, seven different investment accounts. What do I mean by that? Well, he has a little bit of money in what some of these online accounts. Robinhood, E-Trade, Acorns was another one. He's got some money at Ameriprise. He's got some money at Merrill Lynch. He's got some money at Vanguard. He's got some money. There was one other one. It doesn't matter what it was. Maybe it was Bank of America. And I said, why do you have all of these accounts? He says, because I was always told not to put all of my eggs in one basket. And I get that. He says, because I don't want to put myself in a Bernie Madoff situation where one of these companies goes out of business and I lose all my money. How do I know that all of these different companies could be part of a Bernie Madoff situation? And I said, wait a second. I said, first of all of the companies where you have your money are custodians, are financial institutions, and you've written checks to each of these institutions, not to some, you know, Joe's investment house that says they're going to put money at Robinhood or at E-Trade. You actually wrote it to these companies. So you need not worry about a Bernie Madoff situation. Secondarily, even if a Robinhood or a E-Trade or even a Fidelity were to go out of business, I mean, let's just say they go out of business, your investments don't disappear. He says, well, why not? I said, because all they are is they're a pass-through entity. They're a reporting entity. So if you bought 100 shares of Google through Fidelity, Fidelity isn't holding your 100 shares. Your 100 shares are actually held with Google. I mean, you own 100 shares of Google. They are just the representative firm that is stating that you have 100 shares. So if Fidelity goes out of business, you don't lose your 100 shares. Now, what would you lose potentially if you had invested? And I'm picking on Fidelity, but it could be Vanguard. It could be LPL. It could be Merrill Lynch. It doesn't matter. UBS. The money that is in flux that you need to worry about is the money that's frankly in cash. So money, let's say you deposit $100,000. You roll your $100,000 over to your UBS IRA account, and it's sitting there in cash. Well, until it's invested, UBS has possession of that money. Or Fidelity would have, you know, depending upon the custodian you choose. And what if they went out of business while they were holding your cash? Well, you still need not worry because it's what's called SIPC insurance. Many of these brokerage firms have protection of up to sometimes $10 million or more per account. So if UBS were to go out of business, if Fidelity were to go out of business, the cash that's there is still protected through insurance. But not the investments. The investments can fluctuate. They'll go up and down. But if they go out of business, you still own your shares. So with all of that said, he began to realize that, wait a second, I have one investment in each of these seven companies. He had one investment at E-Trade, one investment at Acorns, one investment at Robinhood, one investment at Ameriprise. And I said, you're going to drive yourself crazy. I said, because each one of those accounts requires you to get a 1099 at the end of the year, which you need to report to the government and put on your, you know, your tax form. And he says, well, how do I get my 1099? I said, well, it's on your statement. He says, well, I don't get statements. Everything's in the cloud. Well, here's one of the things that I'm learning. And I'm fine with people going paperless, but I would encourage you not to go paperless when it comes to your 1099s? I know at LPL Financial, where we custody our assets and who we clear through at Freedman Financial, you can go paperless. But you can go paperless for your statements, you can go paperless for your confirms, and or you can go paperless for your tax forms. In my house, and what I recommend to most people, is go paperless with your statements, go paperless with your trade confirms. Do not go paperless with your tax forms, because you may forget about the fact that you have to download a tax form to give to the IRS. And in his case, where he had 7 different custodians, and he didn't even know what a 1099 was, how are we going to be certain that he's going to report everything properly on his tax return? And those are the instances where the 1099 is reported to the IRS. So if you don't report it and the IRS got it, that's an absolute flag or notification to the IRS saying, we need to reach out to you and revisit your taxes. And I know everybody wants to avoid getting that letter from the IRS saying, you made a mistake or there's an inconsistency on your tax return. We need you to refile. You don't want to do that. And all these people that are using these online firms, whether it's Coinbase or Robinhood or E-Trade or whatever else brokerage firm you might use, if you're just using the online feature, be sure you're getting your tax forms sent to you properly at the end of the year. That, my friends, is what I call financial advice in a language you can understand. We got to take a quick break. When we're back, I want to talk to you about our free newsletter we put out. I want to talk to you about how, if you're interested in becoming a client at Freedman Financial, I also want to talk to you about 3 other things. Social Security. You're getting Social Security, you're about to get a big raise come January. That's big news. Required minimum distributions, something that everybody always asks us about. And thirdly, what's going on with this stock market? People are saying to me, Mark, I had such a great year until the last quarter, and now it's doing lousy. What should I do? Oh, I got answers for that as well. We'll be right back. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. Hi, this is Marc Freedman of Freedman Financial. With all that's gone on over the past couple years, perhaps retirement is sounding pretty good. But how can you focus on the future when you're so busy juggling the day-to-day? It's time for a real plan. A plan you can define, a plan you can track, and a plan you can modify as things change. At Freedman Financial, that's what we do. We know that planning for your retirement can be overwhelming, but with more than 50 years of experience, we know what you're going through. We're experienced and we're fiduciaries. We listen and we collaborate with your best interests in mind. You don't have to do this alone anymore. Turn to us for answers to your why, how, and what if questions. If now is the time to get serious about your retirement, please give us a call. We're Freedman Financial of Peabody. Financial advice in a language you can understand.
Visit FreedmanFinancial.com. That's Freedman, 2 E's and a D, Financial.com.
Freedman Financial is a registered investment advisor. Securities offered through LPL Financial. Member FINRA, SIPC.
The following message is brought to you by Freedman Financial of Peabody through 104.9's Project Local program.
Hi, it's Daniela from North Shore Hospitality Group, Daniela's Cafe Danvers, Polana Steakhouse, and the new Daniela's Ristorante in Peabody, reminding you to support your local restaurants. Stop by the cafe for pasta and pastries. Enjoy a cocktail on our heated veranda at Daniela's Ristorante, or indulge in prime steaks and seafood at Polana Steakhouse. Dine in, take out, or purchase gift cards from all of our locations. Daniela's Cafe Danvers, Polana Steakhouse, and the new Daniela's Ristorante Peabody.
Welcome back to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9, 819 here on the, what's the date here? The 17th of October. Yeah. 17th of October. It's a nice day outside. Hopefully you get out this weekend. If you're heading to Salem, you better be there already because traffic is going to kick in really soon. Haunted Happenings is really big and the weather has been fabulous out in the Salem area. Also, I got to tell you, the weather was fabulous at the Topsfield Fair last week. So thanks to everybody that joined us. So thanks to everybody that participated in the fair. We had a record year for ourselves at the booth. And I actually don't know that the crowds were as large as they've been in years past. I mean, it was busy on the weekend, but I think we've seen even bigger crowds. So great year. I talked to Jamie O'Brien yesterday when I was over at the at our booth breaking it down and taking some things apart. And he said he was very happy with how the fair went, despite all the COVID restrictions and all the things that they had to try to put into place. It was quite the successful fair. So thanks, everybody, for coming out. Don't forget about all the other great fall events that go on all around our local community. Of course, Haunted Happenings is big, but man, there are more outdoor concerts. There's live music going on. There's apple picking. There's haunted hayrides. There's so many different things to do, see and do right here in the New England area. It's very popular. So popular that I was here last Sunday, and I was driving down to Restaurant Depot because we had run out of French fries at the booth. I had to fly down to Restaurant Depot in Everett and pick up French fries. And as I'm driving down, I see the Red Roof Inn. There's a Red Roof Inn over on Route 1 going northbound. And the sign at the Red Roof Inn read $369 per night. I'm like,
what?
I was like, what? $369 at the Red Roof Inn? Well, apparently last weekend was a huge weekend for travel. I mean, the downtown hotels, a friend of mine who's over at the Lowe's Hotel, he's the general manager over there. He was saying their nightly room rate was $650 in Boston for a room at the Lowe's Hotel. It was insane because there's a lot of parents' weekends that were going on. There's also people coming in for leaf peeping, heading up north. And people were getting their money. I was like, the Red Roof Inn, usually it's $69 a night. And it was three. And I'm thinking to myself, maybe it's just wrong. Maybe that's just not the right price.
It's a typo.
Right. So I'm driving down a little further. There was that, one of these suites. So there's all night. It wasn't Spring Hill Suites. It was further down. They had a posting up there, and they were $319 for the night. I'm like, is someone adding an extra digit here to the signs? Are people actually paying that? Or maybe everyone's on points. I don't know. But it seemed to be outrageous. So this is a very, very popular time here in the New England area. So if someone calls you up and says, hey, can I crash at your place tonight? It's probably because they don't want to spend $300 at a local hotel for the evening.
I'll give it to you for three and a quarter.
That's right. If you wanted to get into the Airbnb business or the vacation rental by owner, the Verbo, I guess they call it, it might be a great weekend to start doing that.
If it's considering getting into extortion, this is now's the time.
I guess so. But we don't talk about extortion here on the radio. You know, we got to keep things legal.
We don't.
Early on, in the first the first segment, we were talking about illegal activity. We don't talk about illegal activity here. We talk about legal ways in which you can better yourself and find financial success for yourself by being smart, by being responsible, by being thoughtful in the way that you take the way that you plan your financial future. So when I last left you, I was telling you about the story of a conversation I had with a young gentleman out in California, 28 years old, doing really well, working for a high-tech company, and he's got his money invested all over the place. I mean, he had $80,000 spread over seven different companies simply because he was told never to put all of his eggs in one basket. And I tried to explain to him, one of those accounts, you pick one, they were all legitimate companies. So pick one of those companies, whether it's Robinhood or E-Trade or Fidelity or Merrill Lynch or whatever any of the accounts were that he had it with, pick one and you could hold all of your investments in one of those accounts. And he says, but wouldn't that be not putting all of my eggs in? Wouldn't that be putting all of my eggs in one basket? And I explained to him, the basket that we're working with, you have to make sure that the basket is solid, that the basket that you're putting your money in has protections for you. The investments that you're buying are each subject to their own individual risk. Now, when he was telling me about the different investments that he owned, many of them were what you would call ESG. Have you heard this expression? Environmental social governance. These are socially conscious investing. And I'm seeing more and more young people selecting investment strategies that have some social component, social or environmental component to it. It means that not only are they investing for the future, but they're investing in companies that have a, I don't know why I'm losing my words, but have some type of a component to their vision, to their plan, to their mission to be responsible in the way that they manage money. Like, for instance, if you invested in, someone says, Mark, I want to invest in Walmart. Well, someone would say that Walmart is not a socially conscious investment Now, that's not to say it's a good or a bad company to invest in. I'm not saying that at all. But because Walmart sells guns, you can walk into a Walmart, at least some Walmarts, you can buy guns and bullets. Is that being socially conscious? You know, if and someone said to me, interesting story, about 20 years ago, we were asked to do the endowment for a church here in the area. And they said to us, Mark, we want to be very socially conscious. We want to only buy blue chip stocks and United States treasuries. That's what we want to do. And I said, well, why do you think that makes it socially conscious? Well, they confuse socially conscious with stable, large run companies. And that's not the case. Because I said, well, first of all, I mean, Walmart could fall into a blue chip company, right? But Walmart's selling guns. And I'm just picking on Walmart just purely as an example here. But the bigger one where they said, well, from a bond side, we want to buy United States treasuries. And I said, well, if you're going to be socially conscious, then you better stay away from United States treasuries. I said, well, what do you mean? That's the safest. I said, yeah, United States treasuries are safe to the extent that they're backed by the full faith and credit of the U.S. government. But what is the United States government investing their money in? And 45% of the United States budget goes to defense. And what are we buying when we're defending our country? We're buying guns and bombs and tanks and explosives and all sorts of those items. So I said, so what makes that environmentally conscious? And when they started to think about it, they began to reassess, what does it mean to be environmentally conscious? And so you can go now, if you go to Morningstar.com, Morningstar is a research company that researches all different types of investments, from stocks to mutual funds, et cetera. And they have an ESG screen on it. How environmentally conscious is this company? And they categorize it in various sleeves, whether it's for sustainability, for the types of products they invest in, how they manage their employees and all of that from a social, from a governance standpoint as well. Do they have a diversity component in their company? You can find all of those characteristics if you go to Morningstar.com, and actually some of the other screeners as well of investment companies, if ESG is something that's important to you, because it has become an important component to especially the younger generation. But as you well know, like most people, we're all hypocrites. We say what we want to believe in, but then when we find outliers, it says, oh, well, that's a little bit different. That's a little bit. So you got to find what's good for you. And so my job here as a financial advisor, when people want to be a little bit more careful or structure some criterion about the investments that they want to hold, I want them to think through what they're saying. Think through what you're saying. Make sure when you say, I don't want this in my portfolio, I don't want that in my portfolio, is that real? Are you doing it for performance? Are you doing it for social value? What is the reason that you're making these decisions? Because sometimes we don't think it through as much. It sounds great. Like, for instance, someone would say, well, I would never vote for Donald Trump. Some will say that. You know, you hear the word Donald Trump and people are like, oh, I'm not going to touch that. Would you like to pay more in taxes? Well, of course, I don't want to pay more in taxes. Well, depending upon which side of the aisle you want to go to, you're going to pay more taxes with, if you will, a Democratic candidate rather than a Republican candidate. So is it Donald Trump, or is it Donald Trump that you don't like, or the Republican Party or the Democratic Party, depending upon what you choose? You have to really think it through. So, for instance, this past week, got a call from a client who was floored, absolutely floored. Her mother passed away, and her mother has a $6 million estate. $6 million estate. It's a big estate. And she got a call from the attorney saying, you're going to owe $550,000 in Massachusetts estate taxes. And they were like, Mark, what could have we done to avoid $550,000 in estate taxes? I said, it was really not much we could do. I mean, your mom had a house that was worth $2 million. She had a $4 million IRA. It is what it is. I mean, if we had given it away, you'd be paying taxes early at a much higher tax rate. She says, Mark, $550,000. They said, yes, it's 8% of the value. It still stings. Trust me, it stings. Now she says, but at the federal level, you're allowed to die without having to pay estate tax on assets under $11 million. That's true. Now, who has $11 million? That's just a huge number. I mean, some people do, I guess, but a very small number. But in Massachusetts, if you die with an estate over $1 million, you are subject to Massachusetts estate tax. And that could be anywhere from 5 to 17%, depending upon how much it is. And you might think, well, my house is worth $800,000. And I have other assets that are going to push me over $1 million. Don't I just pay tax on everything over $1 million? No, you do not. It reverts back to, you get the first $40,000 for free. The rest of it, you pay estate tax on that state tax. And she says, well, that's ridiculous. Why, that, do you have to pay that if you live in Florida? Nope. Do you have to pay that in New Hampshire? Nope. In Massachusetts. Well, why is it in Massachusetts? I said, well, there's actually only three or four states that still keep it at the $1 million level. The rest are at the $11 million. The states match the $11 million to the federal level. And she says, well, what can we do about that? I said, well, what you can do about that is write to your congressman, write to your state rep, because this issue of trying to raise the Massachusetts estate tax limit from $1 million up to $11 million is trying to push through at the state level every year. But we live in a state that says, let's tax the rich. And this is a way to tax the rich. But how many people today have an estate over $1 million? Many, many, many people do. And I bet all of those people with an estate over $1 million don't feel rich. They're very proud to say that my house is worth $800,000 or $1 million, but they don't feel rich. And so how are we planning to protect ourselves from having to pay that whopping tax instead of passing it on to the kids? Would we do something different? Could we work with our congresspeople or maybe change the structure in our government so that taxes aren't so hard on what I would call the middle class? Trust me, the middle class at 60 or 70 years old has an estate over $1 million quite easily. An estate equals everything you own. So if your house is $700,000 or $800,000, you have a $500,000 in between your retirement accounts, your investment accounts, you're well over $1 million. Oh, and by the way, if you also have life insurance, that life insurance that comes due when you die, that's part of your estate too. Even though your kids might inherit, you know, a $300,000 life insurance policy, well, first, it's included in your estate. So what do we do? Well, I think we need to petition our congressmen here in Massachusetts, our senators and congressmen here, and say, let's raise the Massachusetts estate tax limit. Because you're not taxing the rich anymore, you're taxing the middle class. And I don't think that's right. In fact, 46 other states don't think it's right either. But here in Massachusetts, we think it's right. So the person that came to me and said, and I know I'm going over a little bit, the person that came to me and said, Mark, I'm infuriated that I have to pay $550,000 of this money. So, and then she says to me, where am I supposed to get this money, this $550,000? Because remember, mom had a house and $4 million in an IRA. Well, if she takes money out of the IRA that she just inherited, she has to first pay income tax on the IRA to pay $550,000. So she takes $550,000, has to pay tax on that, highest tax bracket, probably 40%. So she takes $550,000, she'll probably net $300,000. So she really has to take something like $800,000 to get $500,000 and then has to turn it over to the state, or she can wait to sell her house, her mom's house. Now, mom's house probably will be sold and there won't be any capital gains tax to pay on the sale of the house, but she has to sell the house. And she's not ready to sell the house because it has some sentimental value. But now she's being squeezed to feel like, oh my good, maybe, my goodness, I have to sell this house because I have to create cash. It's a lousy situation we're here in Massachusetts. But, you know, we can continue to support the current people we have in office today who support this Massachusetts estate tax staying at $1 million, or we can change that. Because there are candidates in every county, in every ward, in every precinct that run against those candidates that are fighting for you. They're fighting for you to actually try to help you save some tax money. If that's what you want, I'm not saying that's what you want. Maybe you don't want that. But if you do, you might want to think about what side you're going to fight for this year. Totally up to you. All right, that, my friends, is what I call financial advice in a language you can understand. We got to take a quick break. It's 8:34 on the 17th of October. We will be right back. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9.
The following message is brought to you by Freedman Financial of Peabody through 104.9's Project Local Program.
Hi, it's Daniela from North Shore Hospitality Group, Daniela's Cafe Danvers, Polana Steakhouse, and the new Daniela's Ristorante in Peabody, reminding you to support your local restaurants. Stop by the cafe for pasta and pastries, enjoy a cocktail on our heated veranda at Daniela's Ristorante, or indulge in prime steaks and seafood at Polana Steakhouse. Dine in, take out, or purchase gift cards from all of our locations. Daniela's Cafe Danvers, Polana Steakhouse, and the new Daniela's Ristorante, Peabody.
Hi, this is Marc Freedman, president of Freedman Financial and host of Dollars and Cents, heard here Sundays from 8 to 9 a.m. Let's face it, your retirement will be nothing like your parents. Your life won't be based on a fixed income, and instead, in today's world, it will be up to you to make tax-smart decisions on your 401k, your IRAs, and the rest of your investment portfolio. And it's all with a goal of using this money to support your spending needs for the rest of your life. This is serious business, and at Freedman Financial, we can help. With more than 50 years of experience serving this local community, we deliver financial advice in a language you can understand. Visit us at FreedmanFinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, Financial.com. Let's make your retirement all that you've dreamed it could be.
Visit FreedmanFinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, Financial.com.
It's not about the money, money, money. We don't need your money, money, money.
I don't care what they say in that song. It is about the money. It is about that. It's not about how much money you have, but it's how smart you are with the money that you do have. You have to make smart decisions. My name is Marc Freedman. I'm president and CEO of Freedman Financial, located in Peabody, Massachusetts, right across the street from the North Shore Mall, just above Daniela's Ristorante on 41 Cross Street. This show is called Dollars and Cents, and we try to provide financial advice in a language you can understand. And folks, it is about the money. It's about the smart decisions you make with your money. And I see a lot of dumb decisions. No, look, I make dumb decisions with my money too. Do I need to spend money like I spend money on, you know, on food, on clothes, and all that kind of stuff? No, there's a lesser expensive way to go. There always is. But we have to be thoughtful in the way we spend our money, the way we use our money, the way we think about how we gift our money, the way we spend it on others. Because we have to think about living with one foot in the present and one foot in the future. And that's what I always try to encourage my clients to think about. I know you want to be generous. I know you want to be supportive, but don't do it to your detriment. Years ago, we held a seminar for our clients. And generally when we hold seminars, we just do it for our clients. They're always allowed to bring friends. But as part of the meeting, I asked a question, and I've shared this on the radio before. I asked the question of the 80 some odd people that were in the room. I said, given the choice to spend more money in retirement and leave less to your children, or sacrifice your lifestyle a little bit today so your children have more in retirement than you did, which would you choose? I'll ask the question again. If you had the choice to spend anything you wanted in retirement, knowing that you might pass along just a little bit to the kids or whatever's left over, or sacrifice your life in retirement so that you are certain that your kids receive a nice nest egg when you die, which would you choose? Now, everybody who I ask this question of has a very strong feeling about the answer to that question. And I will tell you, it is not embraced by everybody. I've asked this question a few other times as well in different settings. And more often than not, it's a 50-50 split. And sometimes, when, in fact, at the meeting that I did it the first time, there was a couple sitting next to another couple. They were both clients. They were sitting right next to each other. And each of them had a different answer. And they started quietly arguing with each other. What do you mean that's what you would do? Everybody has their own approach. Oftentimes, people don't even think about what the end result will be. They hope. And hope, my friends, is not a strategy when it comes to money. Now, there are certain things that we can hope for, that we can hope that the stock market will go up. We can hope that we'll inherit some money. We can hope that expenses will go down or not go up as fast as they might be thinking. But we can plan for all of those things. And I oftentimes ask people to consider this. I want you to focus on the things that you can control, recognizing full well that there will be many things that you cannot control. What are some of the things you can control? One of the things you can control is how generous you are to others. One of the things you can control is how you spend your money. One of the things you can control is how much risk you expose your money to. One of the things you can control is how much you want to spend time fixing and repairing and doing things in your house rather than hiring outside people. There are certain things you can't control. The direction of inflation or interest rates or what happens in the stock market. You can't control whether you'll have your job tomorrow. Think about that. You can't control whether the cost of health insurance or Social Security will increase, decrease, or go away. You can't control all those things. Sure, I guess you can go out to some forums and rally and be an advocate or, you know, go to some protest or something. But yeah, can you really control anything that happens from that? Not really. What can you control when it comes to your money? What do you have to control? And wouldn't it be nice to know that you have enough money so some of the things that you could control, you don't have to worry about anymore? Now that's freedom. That is financial independence. Knowing that you have enough money so that the things that you could control, you don't have to be so worried about anymore. Earlier in the show, I was talking to you about a young gentleman that I spoke with who was a son of one of my clients. We had a Zoom call and he says to me, "Mark, I want to be part of the FIRE community." Now, for many of you, you probably have never heard of the FIRE community. FIRE is an acronym, and it's an acronym being embraced by the 20 and 30-year-old community. FIRE stands for Financial Independence, Retire Early. Many people in this generation are hearing about 20 and 30-year-olds who join a startup, and by 32 years old, have sold the startup or have sold stock that they have so much money that they don't have to work anymore. They have financial independence and they can retire early. Folks, the likelihood of that happening is the likelihood of you making it on the Red Sox. Okay, there's always a few folks that will have that happen. But the FIRE community is far smaller. And those that try to go into it realize, oh my goodness, expenses are far larger than I ever thought in my life. And it's a lot easier to cover your expenses when there's a regular paycheck coming into the house. But when there's not a regular paycheck coming into the house, you have to start dipping into all of your savings. And that can be dangerous. What you need to start thinking about, what we all need to start thinking about, is living with a foot in the present and a foot in the future. What do I need to support my lifestyle today so that I can continue to support my lifestyle in the future as well as I've supported it today? And it's interesting. It takes time. It takes a lot of time. It's not something that you achieve over 5 years or 7 years or 8 years. It's achieved over 30 years and 40 years. Most people will say, geez, I wish I had advice or someone had given me advice when I was 18 or 22 rather than getting advice when I'm 52 and 55. I wish I had put some of my money in the 401k plan. I wish I had put some of my money aside. And folks, you can do it now. You can start right now. Are you allocating 10% of your earnings and putting it somewhere? Are you putting it in your 401k? Are you saving in an investment account? Are you setting up a Roth IRA? It doesn't matter which one, just do it. Are you putting money aside? But do it in something more than just a bank account. Bank accounts pay nothing. I don't care whether you work with an advisor who is charging you a commission, or working with an advisor who charges you a fee, or working with a financial institution where you do it on your own. The fact that you're doing it is all that matters, because over time, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years from now, you will be so happy that you participated in the economics and the growth of this country. It's interesting today that over the past couple weeks, I've heard from people who have received their September 30th statement. It was their third quarter statement. The quarter ended September 30th. And they've come to me and they said to me, "Mark, what's happened? What's going on?" I said, "What do you mean, what's going on?" They said, "My account was just really chugging along really well until about June. And then since June, it's just been flat, nothing. It's gone up a little, gone down a little. In fact, for the quarter, I'm down. Should I be doing something differently?" And I thought to myself, this is starting too early. Remember, the stock market does go down. And when things like this start to happen, people begin to wonder, do I need to change my investment strategy? Do I need to do something different? Do I need to do something to supercharge my portfolio? Well, you probably don't need to do any of those things. If you're well invested, the best thing you could do is keep doing what you're doing, stick with it, hang tight, and markets will go up and they will go down even further. It happens. It happens all the time. And I will tell you, over the past year, the down part hasn't even been that bad. We got to take a quick break. When we get back, I want to try to explain to you, put some context around what is going on in the stock market. But before we run, I want you to remind you about our free weekly newsletter that we put out every Friday. It lands in your mailbox, 10:30 in the morning. All you need to do is go to my website, freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, to ease in a D, financial.com. Go to the bottom of any page on my website. Put in your name, your email address, and hit the send button, and you will start getting planning pointers. Three pieces of financial advice in a language you can understand, sent right to your inbox along with 7,500 other subscribers. We'll be right back. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 1049. Hi, this is Marc Freedman of Freedman Financial. With all that's gone on over the past couple years, perhaps retirement is sounding pretty good. But how can you focus on the future when you're so busy juggling the day-to-day? It's time for a real plan, a plan you can define, a plan you can track, and a plan you can modify as things change. At Freedman Financial, that's what we do. We know that planning for your retirement can be overwhelming, but with more than 50 years of experience, we know what you're going through. We're experienced and we're fiduciaries. We listen and we collaborate with your best interests in mind. You don't have to do this alone anymore. Turn to us for answers to your why, how, and what if questions. If now is the time to get serious about your retirement, please give us a call. We're Freedman Financial of Peabody. Financial advice in a language you can understand.
Visit FreedmanFinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, Financial.com.
Freedman Financial is a registered investment advisor. Securities offered through LPL Financial. Member FINRA, SIPC.
The following message is brought to you by Freedman Financial of Peabody through 1049's Project Local program.
Hi, it's Daniela from North Shore Hospitality Group, Daniela's Cafe Danvers, Polana Steakhouse, and the new Daniela's Ristorante in Peabody, reminding you to support your local restaurants. Stop by the cafe for pasta and pastries. Enjoy a cocktail on our heated veranda at Daniela's Ristorante, or indulge in prime steaks and seafood at Polana Steakhouse. Dine in, take out, or purchase gift cards from all of our locations. Daniela's Cafe Danvers, Polana Steakhouse, and the new Daniela's Ristorante, Peabody.
Money, 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 money.
Welcome back to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. This is the last segment of our show. We run every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. right here on North Shore 104.9. As I look across the street, it looks like the North Beverly train station parking lot is still empty. I think there's trains running. Look, if you want to get into Salem, Massachusetts today, that's the way to go. I mean, the lot here is empty. Hop on a train. It'll drop you right in downtown Salem. And I wouldn't want to mess with the traffic today, but it's going to be a beautiful day. Enjoy haunted happenings. Enjoy what's going on down there. Take some folks out. If you've never been, it's quite the sight. Quite the interesting people, too, that walk the streets. Biff, you've seen some of those people in Salem, haven't you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting. That's a good word.
Well, I mean, you could just walk around and just people would say, oh, there's an interesting guy.
Look at that guy.
Yeah, look at that guy.
Scary. Love his costume.
Love those suspenders.
Wow. Just love the overall look.
Yeah, you're going as a scarecrow today, right?
There you go. A scare something, yeah.
Anyway, we are here each and every Sunday providing financial advice in a language you can understand. And I promised you that I would talk a little bit about the market because people are looking at their statements that they just got in September and they're going, what the heck happened? I was going to this great run. I was making so much money since March of 2020 when the stock market had the coronavirus start. And then the past 3 months, it's been, ich. It hasn't been, ich. I mean, ich isn't bad, guys. I mean, it has not been deeply down. I mean, ugh, was, March of 2020 when the market dropped 35%. But flat for a quarter? You know, flat for a quarter is still better than what you're doing at the bank. I mean, you're assured nothing for the year. At least there's a little bit of a bump, a little up and down, a little something. So let me put this into perspective. They said, well, Mark, you know, it was such a good run. Should I do something different? No. Did you know that year to date, the stock market as of September 30th is up 17.1%? This is according to Russell Investment Group's Standard & Poor's and J.P. Morgan Asset Management, coming from the Guide to the Markets report that I got from that I'm reading off of here. Stock market's up 17.1% if you had invested in the S&P 500. But what's it been over the past 3 months? Nothing. Dead. Really. You didn't get anything. So what? If we finish off flat for the rest of the year, would you still be happy with a 17.1% return on the S&P 500? I know I certainly would be. I tell our clients when we're building what's called an asset allocation portfolio, something that's generally 60-40, 60% in the stock market, 40% in the bond market, to expect somewhere between 6 to 8% on average. And chances are the likelihood of it landing between the 6 to 8 number on an annual basis is very, very small. You're likely to do better than 6 to 8 in some years and worse than 6 to 8 in some years, but over time, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, you'll probably average around 6 to 8%. So let's be realistic. If you're disappointed in your returns for the quarter, I think you really need to revisit your overall investment strategy. Take a look at why things are up and why things are down. So here's something that's really interesting. For the longest time, the growth side of the stock market has far outperformed what's called the value side. And let me try to explain to you the difference between growth and value. Every stock that trades on the stock exchange is in business to make money. I mean, Elizabeth Warren might not like that, but that's what we're in the business to do. And you know what? Those CEOs want to become millionaires and billionaires because they have a lot of people investing in their companies. They want to do right by their shareholders. They want their shareholders to make money and they want to grow. Now, there's growth companies and value companies. The growth companies generally are taking the profits of their company when they have it, and they take those profits and they reinvest it back into the company to make something new and improved. Take a look at someone like Google or Apple or Tesla or Amazon or Netflix or any of these companies. Does Netflix look the same as what it looked like 10 years ago? Does Google look the same? Does Apple look the same? Does Amazon look the same? No. They know that they have to continuously evolve to be better. Those are growth companies. Do they generally pay dividends? Nope, they do not. But when they're investing, when they're growing, they're growing. I mean, they're doing really well. And there are periods of time when they can't grow so fast. Here's one reason why some companies can't grow so fast. They can't get a semiconductor to put in their appliances or their automobiles or whatever it might be. They just can't do it. So they're not growing as fast. But the other side, the value side, those companies are generally ones that take their profits and they return it to the shareholders in the form of a dividend. They're not going to grow as fast. I mean, how much does Bank of America really need to change itself? Bank of America might come up with a cooler app, but at the end of the day, they still lend money. You still go in there to make a deposit. You can get a mortgage. I mean, how different is Bank of America? How different is Caterpillar? It's a big tractor. What are they going to get? Better treads on the tires? Quicker mechanics so that they can pick up heavier stuff? I mean, those are what are called value companies. Another company is all these utility companies. Electricity is electricity. Has your electricity been any better than what it was 10 or 15 years ago? No, but perhaps the companies have found ways to make it more efficient to deliver electricity to you. But at the end of the day, you just want to hit the switch and the light goes on. That's all you care about. So what's interesting is the companies that were struggling for a while, the energy companies, for instance, the gas companies, the utility companies, whose performance in the stock market over the past few years has been horrible. Well, year to date, the best performing place to invest in the stock market year to date has been in energy. Energy. Now, would you think about investing in companies like Chevron or ExxonMobil or companies that produce gas, those types of companies? They're up 54% year to date. But the couple of years prior, they were the worst performing place to invest. Well, think about this. I mean, you've seen how much gas prices have gone up. If gas prices are going up at that rate, that means energy companies are making money. How about financials? Financials, two other places which are up big. Yeah, financials up 32% year to date. Why are financials up so big? Well, more and more people are borrowing money. More and more people are borrowing money so that they can buy houses, and more people, because of all of these stimulus checks and all the money that they're all making, they're adding more and more and more and more money to the bank. Banks have so much cash right now, and if the banks don't have to pay you interest, but they can lend money out and make interest, they make money. That's how that all works. Now, many people have been silly enough to not take money out of the bank and invest it because they say, well, it's safe at the bank. Yes, you want to keep money in the bank. Absolutely, you want to keep money in the bank. 3 to 6 months expenses, that's important to keep in the bank. If you've got a big expense coming up, a home purchase, a car, something big that you need cash around, yes, keep it in the bank. But if you're not going to touch that money for 3 years, 5 years, get it out of the bank, folks. There's a better way to handle that. Third place that's doing really well is real estate. Think about that. Real estate. If you had invested in real estate right now, and I'm not talking about residential real estate, commercial real estate, those prices are starting to go up now. And you're thinking, commercial real estate? What do you mean? I thought people aren't going back to the office. Well, they may not be. But a lot of people are buying commercial real estate, preparing themselves to reinvent themselves. The real estate of the future is going to look far different from the real estate of what you remembered. So those are what are called value stocks. They are doing really well. In fact, year to date right now, if I look at my year to date chart, the value group is up somewhere around 20% year to date. Well, the growth side of the equation is up 10. Yet, if we look at since the peak of the stock market from February of 2020, the market is up the growth side is up on the 40s, the value side is up in the 20s. That's over the past year. But since the low of the stock market, and here's the big one, it doesn't really matter where you invested. If you stayed invested since the low March of 2020, on the growth side, you're up 112%. On the value side, you're up about 100%. Is anybody complaining? That's almost a double in about 18 months. Folks, the lesson to learn here is continue to remain allocated, spread your money around, make sure you're getting proper guidance, make sure your risk tolerance is in line with your future. Speak with a certified financial planner professional. If you'd like to talk with us, we're here and ready to help you out. But I got to run. I got to turn this show over to Scott Whitley, who's got Wicked Bites Radio. He's got lots of great stuff coming up this week. I don't know what his topic is, but it's always something great. I'm sure of it. Scott, I'm going to turn it over to you. I got to get out of here. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9.
Thanks for tuning into Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial. During the show, specific investments may have been discussed. These discussions are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations. Please consult a certified financial planner, tax professional, or attorney to determine what is appropriate for you. Consider your investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of an investment company before investing. That's because investing involves risk, including a loss of principal. A prospectus contains this and other information about mutual funds, variable annuities, and variable annuity subaccounts. Prospectuses should be read carefully before making an investment. Securities are offered through LPL Financial, member FINRA and SIPC. Investment and financial planning advice is offered through Marc's firm, Freedman Financial, which is a registered investment advisor and a separate entity from LPL. Thanks again for tuning in. See you next Sunday at 8 a.m.